I now call the Huntsville City Council meeting to order. If all that would like to and are able to, please rise for a moment of silence in memory of the victims of 9/11 and the servicemen, and also in honor of the first responders and those who serve, and then followed by the Pledge of Allegiance led by the Boy Scouts in attendance. All rise. Scouts, if you'd lead us in the pledge, please.
If you'd please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Scouts. And while you're up, will you tell us your name and what troop you're from?
Yes, my name is Harrison Smith from Troop 633. We are posted at First Presbyterian, just a few blocks away. And we're here to get signed off for the two requirements for communications and citizenship in the community, where we have to attend a city council meeting and get an agenda and then eventually write a report on that. So, yes.
Well, welcome, and let us know if we can help you in any way.
All right, thank you very much.
And do we have a scout from Holy Spirit, Troop 361, with us? So if you'll go to the microphone and introduce yourself, please.
Hello, my name is Blake McCraw, and I'm from Troop 361 at Holy Spirit. And I'm here for the requirement and citizenship of the community to attend a city council meeting.
Great, welcome. Glad you're here. Council minutes. The minutes have been received from the August 28, 2014 meeting and the September 2, 2014 meeting, and they'll stand approved if there's no objections. We're now at resolutions and special recognitions. Mayor, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. If I could ask Joy McKee or Robin Cox, Joy, to come forward, please. We have a resolution today. And our resolution is for Drive Electric Week. We have found that Drive Electric is a sustainable way to drive. You use less energy as you drive. In fact, I have an electric car myself, which gets, when I'm on electricity, almost 109 miles per gallon, the equivalent of the electricity that you use. So it's great to have that. And this is our way of recognizing this week. This is Drive Electric Week, and the Tennessee Valley Electric Vehicle Driver Group this Saturday will be meeting on September 13th at 10 to 2 at the Solar Park on Airport Road to view the cars, take demo rides, and learn more about not having to buy gasoline to get around, which in our case is a good thing. Joy, you want to tell us a little bit more about it?
Well, Mayor, we're excited because Woody Anderson Ford actually gave Operation Green Team a car. So we drive all electric as well. And this just is calling attention to all the activities and all the excitement that's going on in the community about driving with electric cars and using alternative fuels. So we hope everybody comes out to it.
And here's our resolution that names this as National Drive Electric Week. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mayor.
And Michael Holderer was going to come up, and he's going to give us a little report from the Bicycle Safety Advisory Committee. Come on up here. Come on up here. Tell us about what the activities have been and the great ride that you went on 2 weeks ago.
Oh, it was great fun, and I just came here to talk about it a little bit. On August 23rd, we had the Mayor's Bike Ride. I believe that you really amped it up there when you gave us all the Ice Bucket Challenge and took it on yourself, so thank you for that. There are great pictures of this event on our website. And
give them the address of the website.
Let's see, huntsvillebike.org, right, I believe.
Huntsvillebike.org.
Okay, all right. appreciate you being on TV at so early in the morning. I know that's hard. And okay.
Good.
All right. Yes. Good. All right. Can I talk a little bit more about other news?
Please.
All right. Thank you. We have had some accidents here in town, but I'd say overall, Hunts cycling is alive and growing in Huntsville. The See and Be Seen campaign is over, and signs on buses are still there, but they've been well received. We had a bike summit in Huntsville earlier this year, and that was the first in Alabama. We had a visitor here from the League of American Bicyclists, and they gave us some tips about how to become a bicycle-friendly community. So I think we'll be back in touch, and I'd like to invite the council to ask staff about what's going on in their areas about bike-friendly and how to make bike ped more accessible in this town. Thank you.
Michael, thank you very much for what y'all have done. This is a totally volunteer group that promotes bicycle safety and bicycle awareness in the city of Huntsville, and also puts together activities so that people can enjoy riding bikes. They also are very great advocates for bike lanes to make sure that we have more and more bike lanes. And over the years, you've been the great advocate that has pushed us along to make sure that we are a sustainable community like that. So thank you very much, and thank you for your work. And next year, before the mayor's bike ride, I'll check my tires so that I won't be running with a very low tire. They had me scared my bicycle tire was going to go out. That would not have been good for the mayor's bike tire to go out in the mayor's bike ride. We've also got tonight, I'd like to ask Reverend Herndon and Kenny Anderson to come forward, because we have the CAFY Student Young Citizen of the Month. Kenny? Reverend Herndon, how are you?
Thank you, Mayor. Would the other folks that are with me tonight come up, people who are part of the CAFY team? Tonight is my privilege to recognize our August winner for the Star 99 CAFY Young Citizen of the Month. His name is Wallace Parham, and Wallace is a recent honors graduate from Sparkman High who spent 4 years playing football and also making outstanding grades. He's unable to be here with us tonight because he is, of course, an excellent student. And so he is away at school at the University of South Alabama, and we're very happy for that. But we have his parents, Ken and Lorraine Parham, and we want them to accept these items on behalf of our team tonight and say to your son how glad we are that he's a part of this community and enriching the quality of life with his service. He's been a volunteer, I understand, for the last 11 years with the multiple sclerosis team, marching along with them as well as raising funds. He's volunteered for the Burritt. He's very active in his church at St. John AME. And so he is a model citizen for our community, and we thank him for that. At this time, we have a few other people that are going to present some items, and I'm just going to allow them to do that. I'll let Buzz go first.
Thank you, sir. I'm Buzz Stevens with Star 99. Your son, a very, very young, good man. And I think that comes from leadership, and it comes from the parents. I think that's something the parents instill in their kids. So please accept this as a small token. School supplies in there, you know, that can always come in handy, and dinner for you guys.
Thank you.
So congratulations once again to Wallace.
Hello, I'm George Dugan with Dyncor International, and I want to say thank you very much. We're very proud of Wallace and his achievements, and also his inspiration to other young folks in the community. We think that's wonderful, and we'd also like to present him with a few things.
Thank you
very much.
And on behalf of the Human Relations Commission of Huntsville, we'd like to present a certificate of Wallace's achievement.
Thank you.
Okay. Looking for great things from him.
Okay, thank you.
We're very grateful for this opportunity to present these small tokens of our appreciation, and also want everyone to know that each month this is something that we do, so we're looking for nominations for young people in the community who are doing outstanding things. They can actually go on the Star 99 website and get the application, and we're looking for nominations. So thank you very much once again for your success.
What a wonderful thing. Thank you very much, Kenny. Thank you for doing that. Mr. President, could we ask that we take item 16C1 out of order, please?
16C1 is the deeds for acceptance. Council members, with your permission, would like to take it out of order, and the chair will move for approval. We have a second by Dr. Showers. Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. Mayor.
And if I could get Joy and Margaret Ann Goldsmith, please, to come forward. Many of you know about Goldsmith Shipman Field. For years, since the 1930s, that field has been the place that great football games have been played at. Recently, in the last couple of years, when we were able to work with Alabama A&M to be able to start doing high school games up there, the Goldsmith Shipman Field became something that the school board didn't need, so they let go of it. And the property has always been deeded to the city with a reversion clause that it would go back to the Goldsmith Shipman family if the property ever quit being used for sports. Margaret Ann came to see us and said, listen, I want to make sure that property stays in the hands of the city. And consequently, she has tracked down how many cousins?
There's six of us.
There's six of you, five besides Margaret Ann. She's tracked them down all over the country. I'm not sure how much airfare costs to go all over the country to get their signatures. And one was in Scotland.
That was a nice trip.
But she got everybody to sign off, and the property was donated to the city. And the city's going to be using this property for lacrosse games, for soccer games, for lots of league games and league practices. So it's a great thing for the city, and it's a great asset for us to have just to enhance our recreation. And Margaret Ann, I want to recognize you tonight and your family for doing such a great thing, and we sure appreciate your contribution to the city of Huntsville. Every time you see that Goldsmith Shiffman Stadium, y'all can remember Margaret Ann, because she is the one who made sure that that happened. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Oh, well, all I could say is that the ancestors would all be clapping that the limitations on the old deed that we were able, the restrictions, that we removed them, so now it'll belong to the city from now on. Whatever they want to do with it.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Chairman, tonight we have the budget to be presented to the council. This is our general fund budget. Our other budget will be coming at our capital budget will be coming at a later date. This general fund budget is brought forward because our fiscal year starts on October 1st, so we've got to get a new budget in. But we've been struggling with this budget for several weeks. Mr. Taylor's been struggling with it for several months. It's a good budget. What we can say is that revenues are up. We will be projecting an increase in revenues next year over this year. But quickly, when you look at the costs that are rising right now, the inflationary costs that are rising, look at our pay plan, which is a progressive pay plan. When you put that into place, put in longevity pay, put in cost of retirement plans and everything else, quickly those increases have been eaten up. So it does not leave as much for budgeting process, and it makes our budget process, as I call, a very vanilla budget this time. We left static most outside departments. We left static most departments in the city budget. And this budget is, I would call it a very lean budget. And many people say, well, were there some things you would love to put in? Always some things you would love to put in. But realistically, you need to be in this kind of situation on budgets to make sure that you get the most out of your tax dollar and that you work as hard as you can to make sure that you are as frugal as you can in your budgeting process. So tonight we are going to introduce the budget. The budget does include a 1% COLA, cost of living allowance for employees. And that is in, as we have done over the past several years, we have moved the COLA up 2 to 1% each year, and that practice has kept us from having the big bumps that are budget busters in my estimation. But I'd like to ask Mr. Taylor to come up, our city finance officer, and he's got about 6 slides he's going to show us. And show us where we are with this budget. We will be having a work session on September 23rd on this budget, and we hope to have it passed for the October 1st budget year. Mr. Taylor.
Thank you, Mayor. Council members, as the mayor, he gave you a good brief overview of it, and I will just supplement that with the figures that I know you can't wait to see. But this, because of the work session, we're just going to give you a very high-level review of this, and then we'll, of course, be able to provide you whatever details you need as we continue through this process. What I'd like to do tonight briefly is review where we are with the general fund budget. We're not going to talk about the other budgets tonight. General fund is the largest one, you'll recall. Most of our city operations are inside of the general fund. And so we'll review where we are for 14, and you need to understand that because that becomes the foundation for the subsequent year's budget. We always base next year's plans on where we think we're going to end this year. And then we'll present what we think next year's revenues will look like, or at least what our budget is based on. And then also talk about the significant expenditures that are part of the mayor's budget proposal. And then because personnel is such a significant portion of that, and the mayor had commented about the COLA, we'll give you a little bit of a snapshot there that'll help you understand the dynamic that is part of our budget. First of all, you may recall that our budget for this year within the general fund is a total of $241.1 million. So a year ago, about this time, the mayor proposed and the council adopted a budget that said we think revenues are going to be at this level in fiscal year 14. We've been giving you a variety of reports during the year. We gave you a mid-year budget review. How are we doing with respect to that expectation? And as we see it right now, with the great caveat of significant variability that still remains with a couple of months left, we actually have to wait until October to close our books. We think that we're going to be very close to that number, within 100,000. Now, that's based on sales tax staying at the 2% level that it has currently stayed at for the past several months. So that's where we think we're going to be, very close. You thought revenues would be here when you adopted the budget, and we're very close to that, all things considered. Now, is a snapshot of some of the largest revenues in the budget that are affecting how we think about next year. Sales tax is almost 60% of the general fund budget. As you know, you've heard it every meeting for a while, it's not growing at 3% as we expected. It's only been growing at 2%. That has lowered the floor upon which next year's budget's based, about $1.2 million. Then I won't go through the list. You can see those. We've had some larger ones that have produced a notable decrease, but they've been offset by and large by notable increases in a variety of accounts. Now, that last number of 829,000, we have hundreds of accounts, and none of them are really individually significant, but together they do offset some of the shortage we've seen in other key areas. So that those figures basically show how we ended up very close to this year's estimate, at least as we see it right now. So going into next year, again, you thought the revenue for this year would be about $241 million. We're using that as the base as we move forward into 15. So that $241 million is our base. Next year, we've applied a lot of thought, as best we can, to all of the different components of revenue. We think that revenue will be $4.9 million higher next year, and that's about a 2% growth rate over what we think will happen this year. This is a real quick look. I won't go over every figure, but these are the major revenues that drive our budget. You can see for the ones that are listed at the top, there's about 9 of them. They represent 90% of our budget. All the other revenues combined, those hundreds of accounts, only account for about 10% of our budget. So sales and use tax this year we think will land about 2% higher than fiscal year 13. And then we think in the budget we're planning on a 3% growth rate in the FY15 budget, the same figure we use this year. And then you can go down through there and see that. We've seen some increases this year that were unusual. Some of them are difficult to predict. Some of them we have greater certainty about. But you can see some of the assumptions that we've made in there that leads us to that additional almost $5 million. So we'll talk more in detail about that as this process continues. But this is the most important part of the budget process, because that's how much money we think we'll have available for spending. This is what personnel, general fund expenditures are expected to look like. There's four major components to our expenditures: personnel, operating, capital, and then all of the monies that we use for outside agencies and such. So personnel is the largest component of our budget. It represents about 60%. You've heard us say that we consider that sales tax pays for our personnel costs. Based on the budget that the mayor's proposed, the step raises are going to cost about $2.3 million next year, and that step raise is coupled with all the other movements of personnel, promotions and terminations and all of that during the year. The budget has gone up by that amount. The cost of living raise of 1% the mayor will propose is $1.1 million. The longevity increase plan that the council adopted last year will double in cost in fiscal year 15, about almost $600,000 for next year. Fortunately, health care is trending down. We've just updated these figures today based on costs through this week. And so we think that we're going to be able to enjoy a decrease of a small amount in next year. Retirement didn't go up this year. It was a very nominal change. We are moving the cost of temporary city employees to the temporary service that we've been using this year. So that's really swapping the money in the personnel budget and moving it into the operating budget. Overtime has been a significant driver in this year's budget. We will spend about $900,000 more in overtime this year in our three largest departments than we had planned to, and that is expected to continue for the most part and is included in next year's budget. The mayor is proposing the addition of police officers in response to the public safety need. This represents 50% of the cost for seven new officers. There's other minor costs, but that represents the personnel budget of about $3.6 million. So of the $4.8 that we're expecting next year, $3.6 is used by personnel. This is a quick snapshot of the city's workforce with respect to raises and step raises, because those are large numbers. You need to know where that goes. About 30% of the city's regular full-time employees, 566 people, are topped out. So the only raise that they would receive next year is the 1%. But you can see the numbers of people that will receive either a 6%, a 4%, or a 1% raise next year. They will get the 3% step raise in the following year. So you can just see a quick glance at what the average profile of the city's workforce is in that regard. So average salary is about $50,600. This is just regular full-time employees. Other expenditures, operating costs are going to go up about $2.2 million. The mayor has indicated that that's mostly a level-funded budget, except for the costs that we must increase. Remember that about $1,300,000 is added here for temporary workers. And then other costs, such as repairs to vehicles with our aging fleet and utilities, those kinds of costs are included in that. Huntsville City Schools will increase. There are some agency changes. That's mainly the Von Braun Center and the Convention and Visitors Bureau, which is driven by the liquor tax and lodging tax changes. The Neve Center, the city is required to provide 50% of the cost of operating that juvenile detention center, and that will increase in our budget next year, $750,000. The capital plan will receive an increase because of sales tax, but then there's also a retention that we'll talk more about later of $3 million that will stay in the general fund. All other changes are very small. Now, in the middle of the year, I just want to remind you that not much about this is new. We did expect when we presented the mid-year review that step raises would be $2 million, operating costs would go up about $2 million. And then healthcare, fortunately, we've been able to see some easing of that and actually some savings in next year. So much of what you're will decide through the course of this process will, in fact, establish 2016's budget, because that's just the nature of the Titan budgets that we have. So we'll talk more about this as we go through the process. Thank you.
Council member, so the general budget has been introduced and the 1% COLA has been introduced. Mayor, when do you expect to have a capital budget?
We will have your capital budget by end of next week or at latest the very first of the next week. We will have it in your hands before we get to our budget hearing.
Okay. And council members, tentatively, we have planned for a budget work session on Wednesday. I believe the date would be the 24th, but I will talk to each one of you and we'll announce to the public in due time when we'll have that meeting. But we're going to need to have at least one budget work session before we vote on the budget. Mayor, do you have anything else on the budget?
That's all, sir. Thank you.
We have several resolutions for adoption only. 2A through F are dealing with the same event. Dr. Showers, is it okay to consolidate and approve those and let you describe them? Would that be okay, or do you want me to read each one? Okay, 2A through F are all by Dr. Showers, and they're concerning the Union Chapel Christian Academy Gala. The chair moves consolidation approval 2A through F. Second by Dr. Showers. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. Dr. Showers, do you briefly want to describe these?
Yes. Number one is a congratulations to Master Keston Alexander Edwards, student presenter for the Academy's Gala.
Dr. Showers, I believe your microphone is off. If you could turn it on. And thank you.
Thank you. The first one was, thank you, ma'am. Congratulating Master Keston Alexander Edwards, student presenter for the Union Chapel Christian Academy Gala on September the 25th. The next one is Ms. Catherine Ward, student presenter for the Christian Academy Gala. Third one is Delta Theta Lambda Educational Foundation Incorporated as a civic and community STEM awardee for the Academy. Next one is the Congratulation Future Research Corporation as corporate STEM awardee for the Union Chapel Gala. The next one is congratulating Lieutenant Colonel retired James L. Lauder Jr. as the Lifetime Achievement Awardee for the Union Chapel Academy Gala. The next one is congratulating Dr. Paul B. Ruffin as the Inspiring Young Minds to Succeed STEM Award for the Christian Academy Gala. Congratulating Pastor John L. Clay.
Dr. Showers, we haven't done those, and we'll read those. It's G is a resolution congratulating Pastor John L. Clay on his 35th pastoral anniversary retirement celebration to be held at the St. Mark Baptist Church and Marriott Hotel on September 21st, 2014. Is there a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Dr. Showers, second by Mr. Clean. Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Dr. Showers.
We'll be presenting on this 35th pastoral anniversary and retirement celebration resolution from the council and the mayor.
Thank you, sir. H is a resolution congratulating Glenn R. Pippen, Contracting Officer, Division Chief, Army Contracting Command, Redstone LOS, Hellfire, Hydra Division, CCAM TMA Redstone Arsenal, Alabama, upon his retirement celebration to be held at the Jackson Center on September 25th, 2014. Is there a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Dr. Showers, second by Mr. Kling. Discussion.
Again, Mr. President, I will be presenting on behalf of the mayor and the council retirements of 27.4 years to Glenn R. Pippins on September the 25th.
Thank you, sir. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. I is a resolution in recognition of the Council Training School Reunion 1948 through 70 held at the Von Braun Center.
Move to approve.
Second.
A motion by Dr. Showers, second by Mr. Culver. Discussion.
Again, Mr. President, this is an event that has already taken place. We are going to be presenting this resolution recognizing Council Training School. Council Training School was the first black high school in the county, 1948 through 1970. That event was held at the Von Braun Center. And after tonight, we will be presenting this resolution on behalf of the mayor and the council.
Thank you, Dr. Showers. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. Tonight on the agenda, 15S and 15T have been deleted. And also under vacations of right-of-way, 2A and 2B have been deleted. That's 15S, 15T, and then under vacation right-of-way, 2A and 2B. We have no business with outside legal representation. We have no public hearings to be held. We do have public hearings to be set. 6B1 is a resolution to set a public hearing on an ordinance to amend Article 74, non-conforming lots, non-conforming uses of land, non-conforming structures and premises, by deleting the existing section 74.1, non-conforming lots of record, and by adding a new section 74.1, non-conforming lots of record and unified lots. This will be set for October 23rd, 2014 at the regular council meeting. The chair moves to set the hearing.
Second.
Second by Dr. Showers. Discussion. All those in favor of setting the hearing say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. 6B2 is a resolution to set a public hearing on an ordinance rezoning property on the east and west sides of South Shawty Road and on the north and south sides of South Village Square Road from Residence 2A District and Neighborhood Business C1A District to Residence 1 District, Residence 2A District and Neighborhood Business C1A District to Neighborhood Business C1 District and Residence 1 District to Neighborhood Business C1 District. This will be set for the October 23rd, 2014 regular council meeting.
Move to approve.
Dr. Showers has moved to set the hearing. Mr. Culver, did you second it? All those in favor of setting the hearing say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. 3 is a request to set a public hearing to hear the appeal of the Liquor License Review Committee denying a retail liquor lounge entertainment license to Brazelum Properties, Inc., doing business as Plush Horse at 2021 Golf Road, Huntsville, Alabama, 35802, at the September 4th, 2014 Liquor License Review Committee meeting. This will be set for September 25th, 2014 at the regular council meeting.
Move to approve.
Second. Dr. Showers has moved to set the hearing. Mr. Culver has seconded it. Discussion.
Mr. President,
Mr. Killing,
I want to stay on the topic, but I thought at one point we were going to be looking into buying it. Mr. Brazelton publicly had offered to sell it to the city for half value with him getting a contribution. Have we been able to have any contact with him on that?
Mr. Hamilton or Mr. Jeffrey, do y'all know?
There was initial contact made around the time that the council discussed this some time ago, and the offer communicated by Mr. Brazelton was considerably more than the city was willing to entertain. I did communicate back an offer that the mayor was interested in proposing, and really have heard nothing back from Mr. Brazelton or his attorney since that time.
So that is it, the door is still kind of open on that.
Yes, sir.
I know negotiations take place. I'm not involved in this, and I don't understand everything, but wouldn't it be a matter of just the city doing an appraisal on the property, and then we go to him and say, here's the appraised price, we'll pay half and we'll give you credit for a donation of the other half? Or am I simplifying things too much?
Mary, you look like you were getting ready to respond.
You know, the real question is what do we do with it? And it's, you know, there's not a distinct city purpose out there for it. You know, I understand the wanting to purchase it, but we don't have a distinct purpose for it at this time.
Okay. Further discussion on setting the public hearing? All those in favor of setting the hearing say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. Now, communications from the public. When I call your name, please go to the microphone. You'll have 3 minutes to address the council. Mr. Harold McMillan. Welcome, sir.
My name is Harold McMillan.
Sir, I apologize to stop you. Can you move in front of the microphone and speak loudly, directly into it?
How's that?
Thank you. That's better.
Yes. My name is Harold McMillan. I've lived in Huntsville since 1954. I'm a native of Tennessee Valley. My request to the city council is to provide vehicular admittance, a capability of a vehicle entering and to my family cemetery in the airport, Old Airport Road. It is, to go to the bottom line, it is enclosed by youth activities, ball fields, and et cetera. You cannot access it by vehicle. I myself and some of my relatives that I know of.
Sir, I apologize. We can't hear you. If you get in front of, thank you. Thank you.
Well, I'll hold on. Myself and some of my relatives cannot walk the 300 yards from the parking lots of the ball fields to the cemetery. And I'm asking for a roadway to be open to access the cemetery by. Now, not only do I have family interests, of course, this thing has been on Google, received a lot of publicity. It's been marked by the Sons of American Revolution. They put a wreath on it every year, try to. But I can't walk anymore. And a number of my relatives in this area cannot. So we are at odds of trying to traverse 350 yards, I would say, from the parking lot. It's been enclosed and surrounded by good activities, but there's no way to drive to the cemetery. And that's happened over as a period of evolution. This is going on. So I would ask the city council to authorize departments to proceed with an access road. It doesn't have to be a four-lane or whatever, just so that automobiles can drive that distance.
Okay.
I thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Mullen. We'll look into it. Mr. John Stanton.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm John Stanton. I'm a member of the Alabama chapter of the Trail of Tears Association. A lot of people look at me and they say, where is your motorcycle? We're not with that specific group, although we're 100% behind them for the points that they do to bring remembrance to the Cherokee Trail of Tears, which passed through our area. What we have been doing for the last number of years is we are a grassroots organization, works with the National Park Service. We have been researching, our group has, the Trail of Tears routes that came through Huntsville. As you know, there are two routes that came basically down Highway 72. There's also one that is known as the Binge Detachment, which is the only detachment of the Cherokee Trail of Tears that originated in Alabama. It originated just in Lebanon, Alabama, just outside of Fort Payne. It worked its way into Huntsville via Gunnersville, Gunners Landing, into New Hope, Owens Crossroads, over Blevins Gap, and into southeast Huntsville, eventually connecting to Whitesburg Drive. And what we are asking you to consider is identifying a phase one route, which would include a section of this Binge Detachment route that would, phase one would originate around Four Mile Post Road and continue north along Whitesburg Drive until it basically reached the square of Huntsville. The route through Madison County itself is about 75 miles. It's a complicated jurisdictional thing because of right-of-ways and all. So that's the reason why we're approaching the city first, because of a simplified jurisdiction, the high amount of traffic up Whitesburg Drive, and to identify a portion of this route. This would be phase one. We're anticipating about four different phases because it's quite a bit of work involved and expense for both the city, the National Park Service, and our Trailateers Association. So we wanted to just kind of ease into it and work together. It's a very positive thing. I know I have 3 minutes. There were 1,100 Indians that were Cherokee descent who left out of Fort Payne via the collection camps there. They came through Huntsville for the purposes the route carried them this way, but to buy blankets and tents for the trip. There were 60 wagons, there were 600 horses, and when the detachment was underway, it was believed to extend about a mile in length. Included some of the family of John Gunner, who was one of the founders of Gunnersville, and was the owner of Gunner's Landing. So it's a very positive thing. It's a sad story, but at the same time, it's one that's we as Americans should have respect for because of the perseverance of general human, of the human spirit, because they were traveling through this area in a very difficult time, in a very but I hope that you'll consider it.
Thank you. And we have 15A on our agenda tonight, deals with the Trailateers, and we'll discuss it at that time. And I'm not sure if it meets exactly what you're asking for, but we'll find out.
Okay, great.
Thank you. John C. Stanton, Jr.? Okay. So John Jr. spoke?
John the third.
All right. John the third, would you mind going to the microphone? I need to ask you a question to make sure I get this right for the record.
Stanton the third on 210 Sanders Road.
Okay. Thank you. And John Stanton Jr. does not wish to speak tonight.
No, sir, but he supports me. He's been a colleague, man, as
Thank
well
you.
As my dad.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Jerry Cox.
Jerry Cox, 4029 Tail Star Circle. As we remember the 13th anniversary of what's known as the 9/11 attack on the homeland, let's not forget that 13 years later, we are still having U.S. military being killed in Afghanistan. I wish to respectfully acknowledge the 4 United States Army soldiers killed in the last 4 weeks. I plead with this council, or as my friend and fellow veteran would say, Mr. Timberlake would say, I beseech this august body to review and greatly strengthen Section 72.6 of the City Code on Chapter 38, Sign Regulations. My concern has to do with the posting of political signs. I have here a copy of the application for a sign permit that the city requires campaigns for public office to fill out. In the application, just before you sign it, it says that they agree to comply with the city ordinances and state laws, and they sign that application. Section 72.6 reads in part, the signs shall be removed no later than 10 days after the election. At the end of that 10 days, on routes that I take to my house, there were still some 28 red campaign signs on areas that were in violation of the ordinance to start with. This is not in residential yards. Section 72.63 says that no more than two such signs shall be maintained on any lot in any one time. There are several lots in Southwest Huntsville that had many more than two signs on those lots. 72.67 says the application form shall be signed by the person responsible for removing or having removed said signs within the authorized time limit. So the person that made the application should have had those signs in the correct places. And
Mr. Cox, do you need more time?
Yes, sir.
Please. Council members, 1 minute.
Yeah. And removed within those 10 days. 72.6.8 says no such signs shall be erected on any public right-of-way. There was many signs on public right-of-ways. No signs on public parks. There was a red sign on Bram Springs Park land, not on a right-of-way. On public buildings, there was a large red sign on the city of Huntsville school property on a fence. Public grounds or other public places. No such signs shall be affixed to any tree. As I entered my neighborhood, there was a large red sign posted on a tree going into my neighborhood. And it shall be unlawful for any person to erect or maintain any such signs. So my question to the council is, those signs are still out there today. Is the taxpayers having to pay a city employee to go out and remove those signs, or is the campaign being fined for violation of the ordinance? Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you. Mr. Hamilton, do you know?
Mr. President, I don't, but we'll find out.
Thank you.
Jim McGuffey, City Planning. We do have two sign officers that routinely monitor signs for political events, and we can get with you to have those signs removed if you give me the locations of such signs.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Clarence Johnson.
Dr. Clarence Johnson, 3302 Butchery Drive, Huntsville. Mayor Battle, President Russell, the other councilmen and servants of the city, I greet you on this Memorial Day with the great loss of our American citizens. And I especially note those heroes who rushed in to help out of the idea of the brotherhood of humanity. It is that type of idea that I thought of when Mayor Battle ran for office, and he ran under the slogan of One Huntsville. Now, I still believe that One Huntsville can be an actuality of equality among the entire city based upon the city's ability to enhance all areas. The mayor has even stated that one of his goals were to enhance all areas. But as I traverse the North Huntsville area, I find that we are lacking in economic development. On August the 14th, when the gentleman was speaking about Stone Middle School property and the amphitheater or whatever they're going to do with it, Dr. Shaws mentioned to the gentleman that we have empty buildings in the north along Memorial Parkway. I have since heard that those buildings will be torn down. That may make a pretty sight for those who traverse in and out of the cities, getting downtown and other places of employment, but it does little for North Huntsville as far as economic development and its tax base. We need some creative work to happen in the North economically. For an example, Grissom High School, someone purchased, and I know who all the workforce are, the land from the Hayes family, Hayesland land. And then they sit out, and the object is that retail houses, rooftops, will be built, and retail will be in the area. And this is how you develop an area. Some 2+ years ago, there was an opportunity for the city to purchase about 700 acres of land beginning on the backside of Kelly Springs property. In a meeting with Mayor Battle and Ms. Jordan, we pointed that out. And basically the discussion went that the developers are not interested. Well, I wonder how many developers were interested before the idea of the school going there with rooftops and retail.
Dr. Johnson, do you need more time?
Please.
One more minute, please. Go ahead.
Thank you. So my view is that we could have done this same thing with that property on the backside of Kelly Springs Cemetery. We could have put retail and rooftops there on that northwest corridor that would have increased the economic development of the North. I ask that this mayor and the city council, Mr. Shane Javis and Ms. Michelle Jordan, to take another look at North Huntsville. Speak with the people of North Huntsville. There's property around that you can get creative, just as creative as with establishing a new high school for down there in the South, along with rooftops and retails. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Jackie Reed.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I want to thank you for allowing public input. I always believe we need a prayer in the council chambers. I'd like to hear from somebody saying some good words, because we need it. I want to recognize two employees tonight, and Mr. Jerry Cox, Karen Brown, traffic engineering, came forward, got a bush moved from California Street and Hermitage Avenue, of which people said could not be moved. She followed through, she got it removed. It was blocking the traffic. My daughter said she almost got killed last Friday, and she said, Mom, I thought you were gonna get that bush removed. I said, I'll talk to some more people, and the bush is up, and I want to thank her. She needs to be recognized as Employee of the Month and maybe Employee of the Year. And also, Joy McKee, if you come down Holmes Avenue at the railroad track, I understand the Railroad Authority, Mr. Jerry Cox, and Joy McKee, if you'll come down through there, it looks like heaven. It's not a forest anymore. Need to recognize Jerry Cox, make him an employee this month, Jerry Cox and Joy McKee for the good job, well done. I really, really appreciate what you do out here. I also would like to see in the contracts when you let the new paving do, put it in their contract, you do wide and white lines on the streets. I see that's very effective, and it's really, really good. We can see in the dark. We can see when it's raining. I appreciate that. Citizens, I want the Citizens Academy to read this before you leave tonight over here on this chart, because there's some meetings going on, and maybe it has to do with who's going to run the city over here. I'd like for somebody to take a look at that. I want to thank Goldsmith Shipman, the mayor and all, for taking that property over there. We need that property very, very bad for the young people. I think that's a given, and I appreciate it. I also would like to say that I would like to hate to see any of you vote on taking the Scruggs Center down and the Aquatic Center over here. Leave that out of your RPOs, or a request for proposals, because that's in the center of the city. We don't have anything in the center. We don't have a Richard Shire Center. We don't have anything else. And I understand the good old Holiday Inn property. You're going to suck that up and take it with you. And you're going to build this over on Drake Avenue. I mean, that's just a rumor. I don't know if that's true or not. But leave the Aquatic Center out and the Scruggs Center. My grandson plays ball, and all these kids are over there. The older people swim over there all the time. We got enough retail, more tail, and hotels downtown. So don't take that property away from the center of the city. I mean, you can just buy so much, and you built Bridge Street. I know why we're not going up north, because we're headed out to Bridge Street. Yes, Street. I'd like one more minute.
President, give her another minute, please.
I have to ask, Ms. Reed. I know you want it.
Oh, okay, thank you. I'll hurry. I know we spent millions on this jail lawsuit. People have been trying to get me to ask you to drop the lawsuit, but since I see it's going to come to court, maybe someday you can tell us how much this jail lawsuit really cost us when the time comes. Also, this Cabela thing, before you get through with it, I'm sure that's going to cost us millions. And, Mayor, I'm not too happy with the budget. 1% raise? That would just make a mess out of my paycheck. You've taken enough alcohol downtown from these people walking the streets to give these employees 4% raise. We need to stop the waste and take care of the employees. They are working for the people, and you are making the decisions. I love you, and I'll be back. I'm not going away. Wait, I got to say one more thing, please.
Sure.
My signs, Mr. Jerry Cox, I picked them up on the night of the election. None of those signs hanging in those trees and on those fences are Jackie Reed's. I picked mine up because I might be in the next election. So I never ask anybody for any money, so I have to pick mine up. Thank you.
Thank you. We're at item 8, Huntsville Utility Items. 8A is a resolution authorizing the approval to purchase fire-resistant clothing for electric personnel. The chair moves for approval.
Second.
Second by Dr. Showers. Discussion. Mr. Oshewski has recused himself from this item and will abstain from voting. Call for a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries with Mr. Oshewski abstaining. B is a resolution authorizing approval to purchase a 3-year contract for software maintenance support and upgrades for network servers, PCs, and other computing equipment. Chair moves for approval.
Second.
Second by Dr. Showers. Discussion.
Could I get some information as far as how much this is going to cost?
Sure. Mr. Curtis, can you explain this, please?
If you'll give me just a moment, Mr. Kling.
Mr. President, if I could, let me ask a second question that might be of help to Mr. Gerdes.
Please go ahead.
A couple of years ago, we had the big $20 million software computer upgrade, and I didn't know if this is part of that or if this is related to something separate.
I can't answer that. No, sir, this is not part of that. This is a McAfee and endpoint software that is virus protection, security-oriented software. Having a little trouble pulling up the document that includes the cost, but I'll be happy to get you that information shortly, if that's acceptable to you.
Are you going to tell us your virus software is not working right now?
No, sir. This is just to continue using the virus software that we need to protect our system.
That'll be fine, Mr. President.
Did that answer your question? Okay, and Mr. Oshewski is abstaining. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. C is a resolution authorizing approval to extend the unit line clearance contract for the period of October 1st, 2014 through September 30th, 2015. The chair moves for approval.
Second.
Second by Dr. Showers. Mr. Curtis, could you explain this, please?
This is the continuation of the line clearance program that we have to maintain our electric rights of way. This is an annual contract. You see this every year. It's with Asplund.
Thank you. Further discussion? Mr. Oshewski has recused himself and will abstain from voting. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries.
If I may answer Mr. Kling's question now, I apologize for the time it took me to pull the information up, but the cost on the contract for the software is $34,584.80. Sorry.
Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thanks very much.
We're now at board appointments to be voted on. 9A1 is a resolution to reappoint Rose Allen to the Alabama Constitution Village Historic Huntsville Depot Board for a term to expire June 26, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Kling, second by Dr. Showers. Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. 2 is a resolution to appoint Kim Ogle to the Alabama Constitution Village Historic Huntsville Depot Board for a term to expire June 26, 2016.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Dr. Showers, second by Mr. Kling. Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. 3 is a resolution to appoint Rosa Toussaint to the Community Development Citizens Advisory Council for a term to expire April 12, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Kling, second by Dr. Showers. Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed? It carries. We have a resolution to reappoint Wayne Bonner to the Von Braun Center Board of Control for a term to expire August 27, 2018.
Move to approve.
Motion by Dr. Schauer, second by Mr. Culver. Discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed? Carries. Five is a resolution to reappoint Edna Anderson to the Community Development Citizens Advisory Council for a term to expire April 28, 2017.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Dr. Schauer, second by Mr. Culver. Discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. Six is a resolution to appoint Robert Flowers to the Housing Board of Adjustments and Appeals for a term to expire August 22, 2018.
Move to approve.
Second. Motion by Dr. Schauer, second by Mr. Oshefsky. Discussion? Calling for vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. Seven is a resolution to reappoint Mark Harbarger to the Downtown Redevelopment Authority for a term to expire July 26, 2020.
Approved. Second.
Motion by Mr. Oshefsky, seconded by Dr. Showers. Discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carries. We have several board appointment nominations. We have a nomination of Ed Pugh for reappointment of the Beautification Board for a term to expire October 1st, 2017. A nomination of Ben Bragg for reappointment to the Beautification Board for a term to expire October 1st, 2017. A nomination of Bob Bondenstissel for reappointment to the Beautification Board for a term to expire October 1st, 2017. Four is a nomination of Jane Tippett for reappointment to the Beautification Board for a term to expire October 1st, 2017. Five is a nomination of Donna Alt Parker for reappointment to the Beautification Board for a term to expire October 1st, 2017. Six is a nomination of Joe Green for reappointment to the Barrett Memorial Committee for a term to expire October 1st, 2017. Seven is a nomination of Rick Hempstead for appointment to the Barrett Memorial Committee for a term to expire October 1st, 2016. Eight is a nomination of Martha Jo Smith for reappointment to the City Tree Commission for a term to expire October 8, 2016. Nine is a nomination of Lyle Voiles for reappointment to the Housing Board of Adjustments and Appeals for a term to expire August 22nd, 2019. Are there other nominations?
Yes, I would like to submit the name of Clarine Johnson for a four-year term, Place 1, Human Relations Commission.
Thank you, Dr. Showers. Are there other nominations? We're at 10, Approval Expenditures. 10A is a resolution authorizing expenditure for payment. Mr. Kling.
Mr. President, move for payment of vouchers in the amount of $41,823,398.50.
Second.
Have a motion by Mr. Kling, second by Mr. Culver. Discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. Mr. Kling, do you have any additional Finance Committee report information?
Now, Mr. President, you have announced about the work session, and I guess one thing to piggyback on Mr. Taylor's comments, and it looks like we're coming pretty close to actually coming on budget. Even if we do come up $100,000 short, I think it's worth noting that we are actually seeing an increase in our budget and our revenues over this time last year. And I think we are fortunate. A lot of cities would like to have the type of situation that we have, but we still did have a net increase, even if we do come up a little short on what we had projected.
Thank you. That is good news. Mayor Battle.
Thank you, Mr. President. And to piggyback on Mr. Kling's comments, we are very fortunate to be right here. If you don't have to really bear down at budget time, then you're not doing your job. And this is the time that we have to bear down. We have to look at our expenditures, make sure that we wisely spend the money that the citizens have entrusted with us through their taxes, and we've got to make sure that that money is wisely spent. There's not much left in the cupboard, which is pretty obvious when you go through the numbers and look at it. There's not much left in the cupboard, but we are able to do the services that we need to do. The one thing that we wanted to do was address public safety. We were able to add seven police officers in this budget, which was very important to us for the public safety side. And that's in response to what we think is a focus that we need to have in the community. It's as everybody has said, it's, you know, there's $4 million worth of additional revenue this year over last year, which is a good thing, but there's also $4 million worth of expenses that come up very, very quickly when you just look at the inflationary expenses that we have in the city of Huntsville. So It's as I've told many people, it's a vanilla budget. There's there are not the most departments are level funded. Most outside agencies are level funded, and we've done that on purpose to make sure that we have a balanced budget. Balanced budget is what has gotten us a AAA rating, and what has allowed us to continue to grow and continue to do the things that we have to do. So. Thank y'all for your help in this. And we look forward to talking with you about the budget on Wednesday week. Today was September 11th recognition for 13 years ago the tragedy that hit the United States. We stood at 7:46 this morning with firefighters, emergency response fighters, police officers, and others, and remembered that day. And as the flag got taken down to half mast at the orders of Governor Bentley, it was very fitting to be there to honor those who sacrificed in the tragedy that happened 13 years ago, but also to watch what has happened to our country since then. And our country has rebounded from a tragedy. We would not be defined by tragedy. We're not going to be defined by tragedy. And that's one of the things that came out of that September 11th, 2001 tragedy. This week we have events on the square. Food Truck Friday is on September 18th at the VBC. It's amazing to me that we have food trucks come out and 5,000 people come out and one guitar player, and it's just a great community thing for us. And yeah, this gets back to the old days of the community and people coming down, talking to each other on the square and the downtown area, having a good time. So I want to encourage everybody to come out to the Food Truck Friday on September 18th at the Von Braun Center. Also, the Big Picture Citizens Academy. There's a big sign over here about the Big Picture Citizens Academy. This is our time for input. The Big Picture is our idea of a comprehensive plan that is everybody's comprehensive plan. It's not the city of Huntsville. It's not the councilman's plan. It's not the mayor's plan. It is everybody's plan, and we are asking everybody to come out September 16th at Lee High School at 6 o'clock and September 18th at Challenger Middle School at 6 o'clock, and we're going to be talking about economic development. We're going to be talking about some of the issues that face people on a day-to-day basis, and this will be a good time to sit down and get input from the citizens. The Big Picture Citizens Academy has been very well received, and the Big Picture has been well received by groups throughout this community, and we look forward to continuing that. Mr. President, that's all I have for right now. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Culver.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mayor, I certainly would like to ditto everything that you've said as it relates to 9/11. I remember specifically what I was doing on that particular day, and anything that we do to remember our public servants who made the ultimate sacrifice is very, very well worthy. Just a few things here. First of all, of course, I will be out of town, Mr. President, on the 24th for the next council meeting, which will be the 25th, but I'll be out of town on the 24th and the 25th of next week. And with that in mind, I certainly want to address some of the things that I've heard as it relates to the budget. And Mayor, I've looked at it, and you and your staff have done exceedingly well. However, without regards to the budget, any subsequent personnel action that this council may choose to take, and this is kind of a rhetorical comment, will be without regards to what has already been done with the budget. In essence, if we make any other decision on personnel matters, then it would take precedence within this budget. Also, is Mr. Taylor available? I just have a couple of questions. I assume that he is and will be coming. I've noticed that, and I'm still trying to really get a good grasp of this budget thing. It appears that next year, 2015, we're projecting on an average 2% sales tax, with some months being greater, some being less, but on average 2%.
3%.
3%.
Yes.
Which projects about right at $5 million, $4.7 million in additional revenues?
No, sir, not in additional revenues, not from just sales tax. The $4.8 million was for all revenue sources. Sales tax is about $140 million, so it wouldn't be that much for just that one sales tax component.
But with the overall revenues that are coming in.
It would be about $4 million in gross, but the schools and the capital plan get a portion of that.
Okay, so we're projecting about nearly a $5 million increase, a $4.7 million, not just sales tax, but through all of the revenues.
That's correct.
As an increase for next year.
Correct.
And I'm also looking at a possible expenditure of $3.9 million, thereabout, of that will be taken as well from that additional revenue?
No, sir, it would be, it's $3.6 million for personnel, $2.2 million for operating, and then other costs. So all of the $4.7 million is going to be used up by expenditures plus some. We're going to be taking money from the capital fund to assist balancing the budget. We'll give you more details about that. So the expenses will actually increase more than revenues next year.
Yeah, that has been a concern of mine, and I know you're not per se a prognosticator, but what do you think is what is happening with us? I mean, I'm trying to figure out, you know, we've increased the sales tax to 9%. I'm just having some difficulty understanding why we are constantly trying to catch up.
Well, it's a rather long answer to that, Councilman. The 1% tax, which has been increased, that has nothing to do with the budget we just discussed.
Okay.
100% of that 1% is off in a new capital plan that the mayor and council established. So you won't see any growth from that, and that is bringing in about $3 million a month that's earmarked for
right.
the programs in that plan. But why is sales tax 2% instead of 3% is a question that depends on what is influencing a 250,000 people to spend money, many of whom spend it in our jurisdiction mm-hmm. inside the city. It's a question of business spending related to everything that's going on, a lot of which is influenced by federal spending in this area. So I couldn't certainly answer why is it 2%? Why is it less than we want it to be when we have so many positive things? Again, that's a complex answer. But all we know is what we see in the numbers and the reality of the recession and what we had to do for the past 5 years to pay the operating costs of the city and all the things that got cut out, which was $27 million that we cut out, that just persists, as we've said, over and over. And it really takes a lot of growth to help us get more breathing room in the budget. So, but our costs of operations, because the budget is as it is, put a lot of pressure on every dollar of additional revenue, and revenues are not where we want them to be.
I've attended several ribbon cuttings, and I mean, I'm looking at the Walmarts. You know, we've just acquired or are acquiring two additional Walmarts that generate a lot of sales tax. And I'm not saying it's your fault. I know you can't control that. I'm just curious as to, you know, what would be the primary contributing factors to what is seemingly a sluggish sales tax growth.
Yeah, I understand that, and we spend a lot of time thinking about it and trying to understand it. But the question for most of that sales tax issue is what's driving people to spend or not spend.
Right.
And we unfortunately have a budget, as all of you know. It's the life in Alabama is largely based on a very volatile consumer-driven spending pattern. And so we receive what consumers, a portion of what they decide to spend. And that's both business and individual consumers.
Okay. Maybe we'll convince the mayor to do another campaign on, you know, spending locally in Huntsville and mom and pop. Help us out. Thank you, Mr. Taylor, and, okay. and thank you for your work on the budget. You and your sure. staff have done an excellent job, sir. Thank you. And I do have another item. Inmate labor crews, if I'm not mistaken, I believe they come under the police department. Is there a representative here for the police department? I believe I saw Deputy Chief Giles. Could you come to the microphone, please, sir?
Yes, sir.
In the area of Old Monrovia, University Drive, Adventist Boulevard, around where the Walmart is located on the west end of University.
Yes,
I've had, in fact, I had a long conversation with a resident today regarding the littering. And I thought a part of that was attributed to people who live in the apartments will sometimes put the garbage on their hood of their, you know, the top of their cars, and they'll forget to stop at the bins coming out of Providence in that area. And I see a lot of litter along Old Monrovia in proximity to Providence. But the litter at in the Stepping Stone area seemingly is coming from the general public, just inadvertently, you know, patronizing the local businesses and throwing litter out of the window. So I'm going to be meeting with this lady in the meantime to try to look at some kind of workable resolution to try and prevent the litter. She's talking about maybe, you know, amending the ordinance to some degree or intensifying patrols in that area. But I wanted to bring that to your attention to see if we could not only cite people. I know that we have two statutes, one under Title 32, Rules of the Road, and then one under Title 13A that addresses criminal littering. And we could maybe get some strong enforcement out there in the meantime.
Yes.
Perhaps after we've cleaned it up, maybe we can get our inmate labor crews, and they do an outstanding job to help us out in that area to try and keep that area beautiful. She's living in the Stepping Stone condominiums, and she's been there for 21 years. So she's has a lot of pride in that area. So I appreciate you addressing that matter for me. And thank you so kindly, Chief. Okay. And Mr. President, that's all I have, sir.
Thank you. Mr. Kling?
Thank you, Mr. President. There's nothing that I could think of to say other than that 9/11 is something that I hope we never forget, never forget what happened to our country, and hope it'll never happen again, and hopefully steps are being taken to make sure it doesn't happen again. But it's certainly something we don't want to forget, and we need to remember even now the families who were impacted by that disaster that took place 13 years ago today. Mr. President, I know one of the things that we're doing, and I think it's a good thing, is that we're trying to open up the community and make the opening prayer basically a celebration of the many different religions that we have in the community. When we have a situation like tonight where either somebody does not show up or we were not able to get anybody scheduled, if we have a pastor in the audience, for example, I saw Reverend Johnson, I'd like to ask in the future that, you know, whoever is in the audience that we could call upon them to lead us in the opening prayer at the meetings when the scheduled person doesn't show up or we're not able to get somebody. I think it's a good thing, and certainly, I think it's something we want to keep as part of our meetings. Also, kind of piggybacking what Mr. Culver is saying, if there's any other time that the mayor and all five council members would be in town, I'm certainly agreeable to changing the date of the work session for the budget where we can have everybody present. But obviously, we do need to take steps so we can get a budget passed by the end of the current fiscal year. Next Monday, September the 15th, I'll be having my monthly town meeting at the library, and certainly glad to hear from people in the community to talk about issues. I guess we'll probably maybe even talk a little bit about the budget for the upcoming fiscal year. At the last meeting, we had some discussion from the concerning hiring procedures for veterans. And I guess I wanted to ask, is Mr. Thomas, Byron Thomas here? Byron, I know we had some very good discussion at the last meeting. Is there something the city needs to do or the council would need to pass to, I guess, provide assistance for, you know, veterans and homeless veterans to be able to work for the city? Specifically, I was thinking about, could an agency that serves the veterans, homeless veterans, could that be allowed to be counted on the application as being the employee's employee applicant's address? I want to make sure no one is disqualified from consideration just because they're homeless, because obviously they need a job, and you know, I think we could certainly try to do something to provide assistance.
Yes, sir. We would not disqualify someone or prevent someone from putting in an application. We do everything we possibly can to assist people. We do partner with a lot of agencies that offer assistance and support to the veterans and individuals throughout the community. Had a great conversation with the individual last week, last council. And what we do through our department, we make sure we try to make individuals knowledgeable or know the job opportunities that we have. So I promise to partner with him and make sure we send those information. He's going to assist those veterans. So I don't know if there's anything else we can do. Okay. We are happy to reach out to individuals or agencies that want to know about our announcements so that we can encourage them to apply. And we won't let an address be something that prevents us from doing that.
That's fine. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
And is Shane Davis here by chance?
No.
Okay. I'll talk with him later. I wanted to ask if he could take a look at traffic along Governor's Drive going west or in the morning. Of course, I know a lot of traffic in the morning, but I think the city is now taking control of the traffic light signalization.
Dan Sanders, Traffic Engineering.
Yeah, Ken, I'm sorry to know you were here. Basically, I just want to ask if y'all could take a look at the traffic signalization along Governor's Drive in the mornings between 7 and 8:30, roughly, going west and then going east late afternoon, 4 to 6. If anything could be done with the traffic signal timing, I think y'all have taken it over from the state now.
Not quite yet. No, it's still the state's, yeah.
Okay, well, then you may have answered my question already. But anyway, I've heard from people, and I guess y'all have also.
Yeah, we certainly have, Councilman.
Okay. Thank you, and thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you. Dr. Showers.
Thank you, Mr. President. I am saddened tonight to have to report to you that a longtime retired employee of our city, John Laffenhouse, passed this morning. He was an employee of the Recreation Department. Many of you remember him. Is Terry Hatfield here tonight?
I believe he's on vacation this week.
Is he? Is anybody else here representing that Public Works Department? Would you give then the status of the paving project for Pulaski Pipe?
I would not know that answer, but I will find that for you in the morning.
Okay. We got three ditches in my district, Pinhook, Dry Creek, and Borgen Branch. And I guess I need somebody from public maintenance to address that.
Do you just need them cleaned out, or
No. Okay. What I would like to see happen is that we put together a plan to address the problems with those three branches in the north part of the city. Which would entail a little bit more than just cleaning them out. Erosion galore in those ditches in the north. And I have no problem saying tonight that those ditches are probably the worst ditches in our city. And hopefully that we can start just doing a little bit on each one to bring them around. And certainly I would hope that someone can address that from Public Works Maintenance.
Okay.
I do want to say tonight that I am definitely pleased with the work that is going on in the north with in a residential area where we're piping a ditch area in a residential area that's been long needed. And I do know the progress there is moving forward very quickly. And I want to thank Public Work Maintenance for that happening at this time. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Mount Sharon Homeowners Association will be meeting at the shower center at 6 o'clock. I want to say now, I want to thank all the homeowners who came out last week to the Lincolnia Estates Civic Association. The next meeting is October the 11th. And is Kenny Anderson here? Yeah, he is. I want to thank Kenny Anderson for his support and input in helping to organize this Lincolnia Estates Association. I was very delighted at our last meeting in which Kenny attended that meeting for your support and your remarks about organizing and how to keep developed civic association. Thank you so very much, Kenny. On Lincolnia at 6007, we have a light problem at that address. It's at the intersection of Windermere and Lincolnia. Now, the lights have been replaced, and it appears as quick as the lights are put up, they go back out the next night. Tonight, as I speak to you, the light is out. I don't know if it's anybody from utilities here or from our department that who? Okay, Joe. What can we do when we have a light in a neighborhood that when we put the light, replace the lights are being shot back out? Is there any type of protective covering that will still let the light be visible that we can erect to eliminate that?
I don't think so, Dr. Showers, but certainly be glad to have that discussion with our streetlight people. And, you know, in the case that there is not some sort of protective cover, then certainly we can just stay on top of that intersection and be sure that the lights are operating properly as often as possible.
Okay, that address is 6007 Lincolnia Drive. And it's out now. It was out when I left today, and it's out now. And recently it's been replaced more than one time, but it's out again tonight.
Yes, sir. I'll call that in right away.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Traffic calming. There's a need for traffic calming at 2204 Dogwood. Is it somebody? Yes.
Dan Sanders, Traffic Engineering. I'm sorry, Councilman, I didn't get the address.
Okay, that's 2204 Dogwood. In the same area where we are doing some ditch maintenance in terms of repairing. In fact, I was going to have projection tonight, but some of the principals with that are not here, so I won't bring that up tonight. But that street common is on Dogwood. The address is 2204 Dogwood.
Yes, sir. Is there a contact name and number
that I can give that to you now?
Right. Okay.
Stella Edwards would be the contact person. And if you'll call the office tomorrow morning, can give you her telephone number.
Sure will.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I was delighted today. I attended the annual North Alabama African American Chamber of Commerce annual business conference and expo. I presented a certificate on behalf of the mayor and the other council members. The renowned Shelley Stewart, CEO of 02 Ideas, an award-winning PR marketing firm, listed on the Black Enterprise magazine top 100 Black firms in America, was the keynote speaker, and it was a delight. Some of you may have read one or two of his books. One that I like very much is called Inside Out, and you may be familiar with that. Would you join me? I'm going to ask a gentleman to stand. Mr. Lee Wynn has recently been appointed to work for the Huntsville Housing Authority as a project manager. He comes from the city, comes from New York. And he's here with us tonight. He resided in Huntsville several years ago, but he's back home. And would you join me in welcoming him back to Huntsville as a part of our Huntsville Housing Authority, where Michael Lundy directs that department. Welcome, and so delighted to have you back in our city. Mr. Lee Wynn. Mr. President, that ends my remarks for tonight.
Thank you, Dr. Showers. Mr. Olszewski.
I know we beat the dead horse on the September 11 thing, but I just, every year I think about it, and I know where I was, and I was on in Korea in a battalion, and when this stuff hit, we really thought that bad guys were coming across North Korea. So I know what the rest of the world thought, but we were in another time zone, another long way away from here, and it was an interesting world we were living in, and even being in a foreign country. So, Mr. Jerry, as always, appreciate you coming up and starting it off with that. And we will never forget. We will never forget, and I appreciate that. I got to share, as I always do, I seem to always do, about our mayor's great staff. Hatfield has been out, but all the things I need to get done, it's getting done without him being here. So it's a great staff that can handle all the things when the boss, because he didn't answer my dad burned phones. And fine, but it's all getting done. So I called him today. He said he was at the beach. And I said, well, your people are still great because they're fixing things. I got my share of calls this week on trash and holes in roads and things that he normally takes care of for me. I call him. But there's a lot of great Americans that work for him that were making it happen. I'm asking this, and I usually do this behind the scenes, but I really need, John, if you'd help me, meet the right folks with this Huntsville Connect. When the people take their pictures, I think we need to just, I'd like to have a powwow with us about that, because people are doing it, but I'm still, in my other life, I'm getting calls that I sent it, and it works most of the time, but I'd like to get it zeroed in a little bit better and all that. Because I think it's actually a great technique, and I just want to make sure it keeps working. That's all I got.
Mr. President.
Dr. Showers.
Is Dennis Mason here tonight? Madison? Is he?
While we're waiting on Mr. Madsen, I want to welcome the Oakwood University feature writing class to the council. And if y'all could please stand and let us know what you're doing here.
Thank you so much for the welcome. I'm Keena Henson, the professor of the feature writing class. And unfortunately, most of my students work or have tests, and they stayed for as many remarks as they could and then had to slip out. But we will be back. Thank you so much.
You're welcome anytime. Mr. Madsen, Dr. Showers had a question for you.
The mayor referenced the big picture, the next two sites for the town meetings.
Yes, sir.
Could you give us the site and the date of the meeting that's going to be going on after these two at Alabama A&M University?
Absolutely, absolutely. We try not to get too far ahead of ourselves because we're afraid folks will forget. But yes, we're going to follow these two up, which are much broader economic development focused citizens academies, with one specifically on neighborhood reinvestment. And that's going to be on October 14th. I think it's been on our site for a little while. We haven't formally announced it yet, and that's going to be at Alabama A&M. They've been very, very gracious about hosting us. They've actually, A&M has given us a lot of interns and students that have helped out with some of our previous efforts. They've been fantastic. They said they really wanted to be a part of this. So we're going to host it up there. I think as soon as we get through these two, we'll probably push out a good media notice on that, make sure everybody's aware of it.
Thank you so kindly. And I certainly want to invite all of the citizens that live in our city, especially in the north, to attend this opportunity to give not points or positions from the city, but to give the citizens the opportunity to say to us what they need and what they want to see happen as it relates to North Huntsville.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
13 unfinished business items for action. 13A is ordinance number 14624 concerning the annexation of land on the west side of Mooresville Road and on the north side of Huntsville's Browns Ferry Road. This was introduced August 28, 2014. Is there a motion?
Move to approve.
Second. Motion by Dr. Shower, second by Mr. Olszewski. Ms. Nichols.
Ashley Nichols, Planning Division. This property is approximately 103.94 acres of vacant land lying on the west side of Mooresville Road and on the north side of Huntsville Browns Ferry. The property owner is petitioning to annex for city service for proposed future community, for future commercial development, and the zoning process will proceed following the annexation.
Thank you. Further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. B is resolution number 14-654, authorizing the mayor to execute a purchase agreement between the city of Huntsville and Nittneal Partners LLC for the purchase of property along Meridian Street. This was postponed from the August 28, 2014 regular council meeting.
Move to approve.
Motion by Dr. Showers, second by Mr. Olszewski. Mr. Gelfrown, could you briefly explain this?
Yes, members of the council, as was explained at the last meeting, this is a remnant of property that borders on Meridian Street, is not large enough to be developed on its own. The adjoining property owner wants to purchase it and incorporate that into a parking lot. It's on the downtown side of the ditch or creek that's on Meridian Street, and it would serve an office building, as I understand it, and there's a bank that's adjacent to that.
And council members, I had concerns about this, and I went and looked at it, and I can't think of another use for the property, so I'm fine with the city selling it. It appears to be a very good price, so I'm gonna vote in favor of it. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. 14 is new business items for introduction. 14A is introduction of an ordinance concerning the annexation of land on the south side of Parsons Road and east of Hobbs Island Road. B is the introduction of a resolution electing out of the Alabama Tax Tribunal. We're now at item 15.
Mr. President.
Dr. Showers.
Is it someone here, Mr. Hamilton, the attorney, that can tell me what is the Alabama Tax Tribunal?
The finance director would be the best person to answer that.
Is he still here?
Yes, he is.
Yes, sir. I think he's on his way.
Mr. Taylor, if you could explain what the Alabama Tax Tribunal is and why does the city want to elect out?
Yes, sir. The state adopted a new system for managing and overseeing certain aspects of state and local taxes about a year ago. And one aspect of those was to centralize the hearing of appeals that taxpayers may have
If they want to appeal, as I've explained to you before, a tax that the city believes is owed. So they will centralize that process for anybody that wants to participate. And that's a good thing. It's more efficient for the taxpayers and provides a central means for doing that. It's also good for local governments. In this particular case, however, it doesn't cover all of the city's taxes. And so the three times that we've had an appeal involved a tax that would not have been covered by the tribunal. And so there was also another tax case involved that was covered. So if this particular situation repeats itself, we would find ourselves having to deal with, the taxpayer would deal with Montgomery in that process, the tax tribunal, for one of the taxes, and then would be having to deal with us on the other tax. And so for the time being, we thought it would be more efficient. We rarely have appeals that go to the tribunal or to our own independent hearing officers. We really try to work those out before we get there. So we think it'll be best, for all things considered, for now, for us to continue to do what we're doing, but we have an opportunity every year to reevaluate that and then participate in that system.
Thank you, sir. And this is for introduction only. Are there questions? 15, new business items for consideration or action. 15 S and T have been deleted. The chair holds 15 A as an alpha and 15 V as in Victor. Are there other items you'd like to hold? We've got 15 A held, 15 V. Are there other items? Hearing none. 15 B is a resolution authorized agreement with the State of Alabama Department of Transportation for the installation and or maintenance of traffic control signals at the intersection of northbound Zurt Road and Nature's Way. C is a resolution authorized the mayor to a license agreement with Dean Moore for the lease of farmland located in the vicinity of Pulaski Pike and Liberty Hill Road. D is a resolution authorized the mayor to a joint funding agreement with the U.S. Geological Survey for Water Resources Investigations, project number 6514 DM35. E is a resolution authorizing the mayor to modify the agreement with Garver LLC for Greenbrier Parkway Phase 1, project number 6513 RD02 by modification number 1. F is a resolution authorizing mayor to agreement with OMI Inc. for construction materials testing services for downtown Gateway Harvard Road Extension rebid, project number 6511 RD03. G is a resolution authorizing mayor to agreement with the Alabama Department of Transportation for Zurt Road northbound lanes from north of Martin Road to south of Madison Boulevard. H is a resolution authorizing mayor in agreement with the Alabama Department of Transportation for Church Street Phase 1 clearing and grubbing, project number STPHV-4500, and City of Huntsville, project number 6501RD05. I is a resolution authorizing City Council to amend the contract with Reed Contracting Service, Inc. for Martin Road on Redstone Arsenal, base bid and option number 1, option number 2, and option number 3, project number 6510RD09 by change order number 2. J is a resolution authorizing mayor in agreement with low bidders meeting specification outlined in the attached summary of bids for acceptance. K is ordinance to amend budget ordinance number 13-630 by changing appropriating funding for various departments and funds. L is a resolution authorizing acceptance of donations. M is ordinance to amend budget ordinance number 12-768 by changing authorized personnel strength within the various departments. N is a resolution authorizing mayor to execute a modification to the original agreement, resolution number 09-885 between the City of Huntsville and VSP for the purpose of amending and renewing the city's group vision insurance benefits. O is a resolution authorizing mayor to execute an application for the city's excess workers' compensation insurance with Safety National Casualty Corporation. P is a resolution authorizing mayor to renew a group accident policy for volunteers workers with Markle Insurance Company. Q is a resolution authorizing mayor to agreement between the City of Huntsville and John C. Calhoun Community College to provide emergency medical technician training to Huntsville Fire and Rescue personnel. R is a resolution authorizing the clerk treasurer to invoke Service First Bank letter of credit number 10-423 for Village of Providence Phase 6A subdivision. U is a resolution authorizing the clerk treasurer to invoke Bancorp South Bank letter of credit numbers 36-70-00-574773 for Hampton Ridge Phase 5 subdivision. The chair moves for consolidation approval of 15B through 15R and 15U.
Second.
Motion to consolidate approved made by the chair, second by Dr. Showers. All those in favor of consolidation approval signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. 15A is a resolution authorizing the mayor to enter agreement with the Trail of Tears Association, authorizing the association to install signage identifying streets within the Huntsville city limits included in the Trail of Tears route.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion by Dr. Showers, second by Ms. Culver. Ms. Jordan, could you explain this, please? And then we had a citizen discuss it. Will you make sure that it compares with what he asked for?
Sure.
Thank you.
Yes, we worked with Mr. Stanton to get this agreement before you tonight. This agreement will allow the city to accept signs from the National Park Association, National Park Service, to install 29 signs along this route throughout the city.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. 15V is a resolution authorizing the City Council to change the first regular meeting scheduled on November 13th to November 6th, 2014, the second regular meeting scheduled on November 25th to November 20th, 2014, the first regular meeting scheduled on December 11th to December 4th, 2014, and the second regular meeting scheduled on December 25th to December 18th, 2014.
Move to approve.
Motion by Dr. Showers, second by Mr. Culver. Council members and to the public, this is done to work within the holiday schedule, so we obviously are not going to have meetings on Christmas or Thanksgiving Day, and so we're just preparing it ahead of time. So all the citizens are aware, we still want you to come and participate, and we just want you to know in advance when the meetings are going to be. All those in favor signify by saying yes.
Aye.
Post. Yeah, threw you off. Nobody's listening. We're now at 18, legal department items transaction, 16A is vacations of easement. We have five items and two vacations of right-of-way, 1A and 1B. The chair moves for consolidation approval.
Second.
Second by Dr. Showers. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It carries. We're now at non-roster communications from the public. Ms. Reed, you have the floor.
I want to thank you again for allowing the public to get involved, for all the people that care about city government. Government's in your face every day, you can believe it or not. It plays a big part in your life, and I appreciate everybody coming. And there's many people where I work asking you, Mr. Olszewski, when will you be leaving office? They want to know.
Trying to get rid of me, but...
I mean, they care. Wait, these people care. It's not that they don't care. And I said, well, there's an election coming up, and there's two people running, I think, for that seat. And he's going to be here. I don't know when you put him in office, but it'd be good if you knew.
First week of November.
Thank you. He can stay as long as he wants to. But anyway, I also would like to say that you sit up there and you vote on these budget items, and then you question them? I got a problem with that. There's a lot of waste going on, and you all pass. Five of you have got to vote. At least three of you have got to vote to pass anything on that city council up there. Just three of you can take a vote, and whatever it is, it'll pass. And we waste a lot of money. I do know that our employees, I work in a place where they come, and I said, are you the only person that knows that when you tell me this? They say, yes, ma'am. I said, I can't bring it up because you could get fired. They tell me something else. I said, how many people knows that? The whole department. Okay, I can bring it up. Because I don't want them to get fired. It's sad when the employees can't tell you what they need to do their job. I know for a fact we don't have enough police officers. We have stretched our city limits almost all the way to Athens. We need new police cars. Tell the mayor next time you see him that all of this budget stuff and some of this, I know he's standing right back here watching me. Tell the budget people to look into all of these things, what they need to do their job. We used to let the department heads come and tell you what they needed to do their job. We don't do that anymore. I can't tell you everything they need. I'd like to, but get some information from the employees. In the aerospace business, government works from bottom up. City government works from top down. I got a problem with that. I love y'all. Thank you.
Bye. Would anyone else like to address the council? Council members, are you ready to adjourn? We're adjourned.